We're going to study today the yellow hypothalamus, which sits underneath the regular pink thalamus, which has the third ventricle, a narrow blue slit, separating the right and left sides. The hypothalamus has two principal functions. One is an endocrine function, and the other is an autonomic nervous system control function. It's an incredibly important square centimeter of tissue. So let's look at it. Let's begin looking at the hypothalamus in this mid-sagittal section. This surface here is the ventricular surface, the third ventricle, and both the thalamus and the hypothalamus are touching the third ventricle. And there is a groove, sort of imaginary groove, called the hypothalamic sulcus that separates the thalamus above, which is all of this big structure I'm moving my probe over, from the hypothalamus below. Now, the boundaries of the hypothalamus posteriorly are approximately where the aqueduct is, coming down here by the mammillary bodies, down here to the optic chiasm, up to the anterior commissure. Here is the fornix, coming from the hippocampus and then back here. So this sort of one square centimeter of tissue is incredibly vital. And let's look at it on the ventral surface. This is a rather atypical ventral surface, but it allows us to see the base of the brain. Here are our optic nerves, and here is our chiasm and the optic tract. So the optic tract and chiasm are boundaries of the hypothalamus. And if I turn it here just a little bit more, you can see the two mammillary bodies, which are the posterior extent. And then this soft area here on either side, this region is called the tuberous nerium, and that hole there is where the infundibular stalk was attached, but has been torn off when the brain was removed from the skull, because there is dura matter separating the pituitary gland from the infundibular stalk. And if I poke my probe through here and turn this section over, what I can see is that it's going to be continuous with this hole here in the bottom of the third ventricle. Here's our third ventricle. So down here, where my probe is the hypothalamus. Here's the beginning of the aqueduct. Here is our fornix. These are front boundaries. Fornix, aqueduct, the side of the ventricle, and then the widened third ventricle in this particular patient. Now, let's start and talk about some of the functions of the hypothalamus and some of its connections. So we're going to look at three coronal sections. The first one is the most anterior. Here is our optic chiasm, and the area right above it and below the anterior commissure represents the very front end. Sometimes this area, a general region, is called the preoptic area. What I wanted to make note of is that there are axons coming from the optic nerve that don't go on back to the lateral geniculate, but instead go to a nuclei near here on either side, the suprachiasmatic, above the chiasm nucleus. And it's very interesting. This is important in setting your circadian rhythms. So your rhythmic activity of day and night is controlled by input of light into this region here. Here's another sample a little bit farther back. These are not from the same brain, so don't be surprised. Here is our third ventricle. This is imaginary hypothalamic sulcus. So this is the hypothalamic region. And we're kind of fortunate because there's just a little bit of the infundibular stalk left on here. And it's a little bit gray because there are capillaries surrounding this stalk that form part of the hypophyseal portal system, which allows hormones produced in the hypothalamus to circulate down to the anterior pituitary, which we'll talk about shortly. Also out here laterally, there's a bundle of fibers which cannot be seen called the medial forebrain bundle. It has various sources and destinations, but the medial forebrain bundle connects the hypothalamus back with the autonomic nervous system and descending control of the autonomic nervous system, as well as projecting forward up into the basal forebrain area and parts of the limbic system. This third section is at the level of the mammillary bodies, which we noted were the back part of the hypothalamus. So here we have that, and we associate the mammillary bodies with memory consolidation and damage here, such as in Korsakoff's disease, lead to problems with memory, as do the as does the involvement of this dorsal medial nucleus of the thalamus. So memory consolidation for new memories in the mammillary bodies and dorsal medial nuclei. Some other functions and afferents to the hypothalamus besides the retina and the hippocampus is input from the amygdala, which is right here. Amygdala can easily funnel into the hypothalamus. And remember, we associate the amygdala with fear, and that is a very, very important trigger for autonomic responses. A remarkable thing about the hypothalamus is that different neurons in different nuclei, and we're not going to learn all of them, have receptors and respond to, that is, they respond physiologically, to circulating hormones from the pituitary gland and represent a way of feeding back and controlling the release of hormones, both from the hypothalamus and from the pituitary gland itself. And there are circulating hormones that affect appetite. We have orexigenic ghrelin coming from the stomach when you're starving, and anorexigenic things like insulin or glucose or leptin. So neurons respond to these substances in the blood, as well as a presence of sodium and the very delicate balance between salt and water. And of course, we have to maintain our temperature for homeostasis. And there are neurons that respond to the temperature of the circulating blood and also respond to prostaglandin circulating as a result of inflammatory reactions. This is a mid-sagittal radiograph, and it shows you on the right the cerebellum at the top, the corpus callosum. And the pituitary gland is indicated by arrows with the anterior lobe on the left and the posterior lobe on the right. And you can imagine that infundibular stalk extending down from the base of the third ventricle, which is outlined, and the posterior boundary of the hypothalamus, which is the mammillary body. So now the anterior lobe and the posterior lobe have very different functions and connections, and we want to look at those in more detail. So let's discuss the posterior pituitary first. The posterior pituitary is really an outgrowth of the floor of the diencephalon or the hypothalamus. And here we can see neurons, large neurons, magnocellular neurons, in the periventricular and supraoptic nuclei. And these neurons make hormones. They make two very important hormones, ADH, or vasopressin, and oxytocin. And these hormones then travel down through axoplasmic flow through the hypothalamal neurohypophyseal tract to terminate as axon terminals on blood vessels that have fenestra in them, fenestrated capillaries, so that the large hormones can move into the bloodstream. And these hormones are discharged in proportion to the number of axon impulses that are coming down carrying these packaged hormones. So a direct output from the hypothalamus into the circulatory system. And these two hormones, vasopressin and oxytocin, can result in inappropriate responses if they are not in proper balance. For example, if you were to have trauma or surgery or a tumor and something should interrupt the flow of these hormones, you could end up with something called diabetes insipidus, when there is too low vasopressin secretion and therefore you pass too much water and you have a large volume of urine. And these people then are always thirsty and want to replenish their water supply, and they manifest what we call polydipsia. So diabetes insipidus results from an interruption in the level of vasopressin secretion. The anterior pituitary has a little bit different system. It evolved as an outpouching of the roof of the mouth. And so the connections with the brain are a two-stage sort of system. We have small or parvicellular neurons located in the hypothalamus in nuclei called the arcuate or periventricular. They're down in that soft fleshy part of the bottom of the hypothalamus called the tuber cinereum. And these neurons produce hormones, but we call them releasing hormones because they flow down the axons but end on capillaries in this portal system that surrounds the median eminence. And then these very short-lived releasing hormones circulate just a short distance to the anterior pituitary and cause the anterior pituitary to release the hormones that it produces, such as corticotropin and thyrotropin. So it shouldn't surprise you that if you had a tumor that was in the hypothalamus and interrupted this circuitry, you would have hormonal problems. Or if you had a tumor in the pituitary gland that grew and pushed up on the hypothalamus, you could have both visual and hormonal and even behavioral problems. So this is a very important and very small area. Now let's think about the other major function of the hypothalamus, that is autonomic function. Hypothalamic control of the autonomic nervous system is very direct. We've seen that all sorts of systems and situations funnel into the behavior of the hypothalamus, and it shouldn't surprise us, therefore, that there is a direct pathway from the hypothalamus down to the spinal cord, and therefore we need to control and modify both smooth muscles and glands. And this tract is called the hypothalamus spinal tract. Now, you can't really see it, but it's there because when it's interrupted, you see changes. So there are two neurons in the autonomic nervous system plan. The first is the preganglionic neuron with the cell body leaving and going out to a peripheral ganglion, and then a postganglionic neuron out in the periphery going to the target gland or smooth muscle. Now let's look at, for example, the reaction when the amygdala responds in a fearful way and sends a barrage of stimulus to the hypothalamus to release a pattern of behavior that would be accompanying fear. So what happens when you're afraid? We always have that sort of trite response called fight or flight. And this is exactly what the hypothalamus and the forebrain decide. Is it time to use your brain to think yourself out of this situation? Or is it time just to turn on the autonomic system and get the heck out of there? Well, when you go for the hypothalamic route, this is the pathway that you see. And ultimately, through this chain of three neurons, you end up with increasing your blood pressure, your heart rate, the flow to the muscles so that you can move out of there. You've got to open up your bronchi so that you can breathe heavily. You sweat and so on. Even so, you also stimulate, for example, the pupils. If you're scared, your pupil enlarges. That is another part of the sympathetic fight or flight response to fear. Lesions of this hypothalamal spinal tract can occur, as you can imagine, anywhere from the hypothalamus down to the spinal cord. This example of an infarct sometime in the past of the medulla, a lateral medullary lesion, is shown here where the tissue has died and where I have put a bright red dot in the approximate position of that descending pathway. When this happens, then you have an interruption of that response, and another classical sign of interruption of this pathway is what is called Horner's syndrome. And we won't go into that, but if you're interested in Horner's syndrome, you can read more about it. So in conclusion, I hope you now realize how important this square centimeter of tissue is in controlling not only your autonomic responses, but all of your hormonal interactions, not to mention things like memory and sleep and wakefulness. So the hypothalamus gets input from almost every region of the brain, and it goes to very many places. It's enough to blow your mind.